Their plumage is usually an elegant black or shades of grey. Some, however, prefer a bit of colour. But all of them are songbirds and unusually intelligent, particularly the largest among them, the common raven, who is also a gifted flyer. Way back in ancient times, ravens were known for their intelligence. The ancient Greeks and Romans, and in particular the Norse tribes, considered them to be birds of the gods. Odin, highest of the Norse gods, sent both his ravens, Hugin and Munin, out into the world to collect information for him. It's said that from time to time, Odin even transformed himself into a raven. Ravens were symbols of wisdom and age-old knowledge. Along with wolves, they held the highest position in Norse mythology as divine creatures. But things were not to remain that way. In Europe, the onset of the Middle Ages marked the beginning of a sinister period in more ways than one. Attitudes towards ravens changed drastically. Superstition and prejudice replaced the age-old awareness of their intelligence. From now on, they were considered birds of death, and it was thought that they were in league with the devil. Widespread and long-lasting wars, together with devastating outbreaks of the plague, provided an enormous amount of food for ravens. These black-colored birds were not only thought of as omens of bad luck, but even the cause of evil itself. Battlefields lay strewn with bodies for weeks and months, attracting scavengers such as wolves and vultures, and of course, ravens too. And as if that were not enough, an arbitrary and cruel justice system spread throughout Europe, providing even more for them to scavenge. The clever birds that had been sacred to the Germanic tribes fell increasingly into disrepute and were hunted down mercilessly. And so, the once revered birds of the gods became outcasts, symbols of death and depravity. Satan himself, it was claimed, appeared at the gallows in the form of a raven to feed on the corpses or fly away with the souls of the hanged. Today, though, a new image of the raven is gradually establishing itself. Their extraordinary intelligence is fascinating. Almtal in Austria. Raven calls. Ravens watching. Ravens flying. What's going on here? Biologists at the Konrad Lorenz Research Station in Grünau, Austria, a field office of the University of Vienna, are on their way to feed the wild boar in the Cumberland Wildlife Park. It's not just the wild boar who are waiting for breakfast. Common ravens come here too, every morning, to collect their share. In winter, when food is in short supply, they come in particularly large numbers. A good place, then, to study the behaviour of wild ravens. Approximately 90 common ravens have been marked with coloured chips here in Almtal, and as a result, they can be studied individually. Ravens spend their early years in juvenile groups of up to 300 birds. Because, to date, so little is known about the social structures of these birds, a team at the Konrad Lorenz Research Institute are studying the subject. Friendships and even close bonds and partnerships are formed during these early years. But only when a pair is able to occupy new territory of their own do they leave the group. Common ravens are known for their intense playfulness, a clear indication of their intelligence. Social and family interaction among these birds is equally pronounced. Common ravens maintain friendships over many years, and pairs remain together for life. The biologist, Anna Braun, is preparing an experiment. Ilias and Columbo, the two ravens in the aviary, observe her work attentively. They follow every step exactly. Ready. The so-called string experiment can begin. Ilias doesn't wait a moment. Straight away, he jumps onto the branch where the snack is hanging. Immediately, he starts to pull the string up. The bird knows that he can only get the food he wants this way. From below, he would never be able to reach it, so Ilias uses the string to get the food. This kind of behavior is typical of ravens. They understand the connections and relationships between things and act accordingly. At the University of Cambridge, New Caledonian ravens even work with tools they've built themselves, an ability that was long considered unique to primates. In the neighboring aviary, the young birds are already waiting for Anna Braun. Today is a day for games, and the young birds are already getting impatient. The ravens play with the toys just like small children do. First of all, they examine them, and then they play as they like. After play, the precious objects are hidden to make sure that the others can't take them away. A good covering of snow, and the others will never find it. That's what you think. A chum was watching and wants the toy for himself. No way. Rumo digs the toy out of its hiding place himself. Hold on a moment. What's going on here? Has the toy disappeared? Rumo goes and checks the other side. Perhaps he pushed it in too far. Eventually, Anna Braun comes to help. Four eyes see better than two. But the toy appears to have fallen too far into the crevice. Neither bird nor scientist can get to it. But the young raven is not willing to accept that his precious toy is gone. Anna Braun doesn't give up either, and finally, she's lucky. With Rumo's help, she's able to rescue the toy. The raven is very pleased. Gymnastics class is great fun, too, even if not everyone in the group is up to it.
camera.
Once again, Rumo is the daredevil. One push and the carousel gets going. A playful young raven can't get enough of this kind of fun.
Come, Aldi Fest. Yeah, come.
The Alps, one of the most inhospitable places in Europe, particularly in winter. Most animals leave the Upper Alps in autumn, or hibernate for several months under a protective blanket of snow. Only humans felt the urge to come up here at this time of the year. But they didn't remain alone for long. Ski tourism was quickly followed by the Alpine choughs, for suddenly there was an attractively abundant food supply. On sunny days when the terraces are open, flocks of hungry Alpine choughs join the crowds of skiers. To begin with, somewhat shy, the elegant stunt flyers become less timid and take their places alongside the other guests. Their dark black plumage and yellow beaks are reminiscent of oversized male blackbirds. Faced with so many birds, some may feel reminded of Hitchcock's famous thriller, The Birds. As with all types of crow, the Alpine choughs are both curious and wary of strangers, but they have learnt that tourists are not a threat. Alpine choughs are typical alpine birds. Up in the remote crags, they rear their young. At the onset of winter, though, they move to milder locations, only returning to their breeding places to sleep. After their meal, the birds take off and make use of the warm air currents. Alpine choughs communicate using special calls and by tilting their wings to pass on flight directions and exchange other information. While up in the mountains winter conditions are still tough, down in the valley spring has arrived. A group of carrion crows lands on this meadow every afternoon. They're attracted by the rich supply of earthworms and the first insects. A real feast after the sparse fare of winter. The carrion crow is probably the most well-known and common type of crow in Central Europe. It looks similar to the common raven, but is much smaller and lacks their strong beak. The discovery of something delicious to eat seldom remains a secret from the group. At once, the others hurry over, and not just because they're jealous. They're also curious to know what is so interesting. In this case, the object of interest is a nut. A fight is imminent because nuts are number one on the raven's list of delicacies. The finder will be lucky if he can hang on to his spoils. Frantically, the crow tries to crack open the nut, but it keeps rolling away, so there's no alternative but to hide it. Now the others are closing in, a sort of mock fight. Another attempt to hide it, better this time. And then pretend there's nothing going on. But crows have very good eyes. And what's more, they understand what they see. And so the whole thing starts again. Finally, the hiding place is discovered. And now there's no stopping them. The next fight is brewing. In the end, a cunning outsider finds the object of desire. However, since his position within the group is not a strong one, he has no choice but to fly off with the nut as far and as quickly as he can. But they also live in our cities. Rooks run through the traffic, as if they understand traffic regulations. There are few habitats in which the crow cannot survive. Amazing how well the birds understand the traffic. There are rarely any accidents. In the cathedral city of Limburg, there's a long-standing colony of rooks. As early as March, they begin building their nests. Rooks are easy to recognize by the grey feathers at the base of their beaks that always seem to make them look a bit old. They collect nesting material from the surroundings or directly from the street. Why bother flying for miles when there's so much good material nearby? Rooks thrive in areas where humans farm. Until a century ago, the farming land of Europe was home to huge colonies comprising several hundred thousand birds. But merciless hunting has reduced their numbers in many places by up to 90%. Even in Eastern Europe these days, numbers are dwindling. The first step is always the hardest. Stabilizing the heavy branches is no easy task, but the colony is growing steadily. The first nests are finished, and the residents have moved in. This rook doesn't have the typical grey face. Normally, this is only the case with young birds. Breeding in the city has its advantages. The rooks are fairly safe from predators. What's more, the colony offers protection for the brooding females and their chicks. But the colony also has its disadvantages. Rooks are pretty inventive and completely unscrupulous when it comes to stealing nesting material from their neighbors. An almost finished nest can quickly turn into a sad ruin. And all of a sudden, the once proud owner looks very frustrated. These birds also brood in colonies and like to be near their bigger relations. The jackdaws are the smallest of the crow family. They are easy to recognize by their black foreheads and the steel-gray head feathers. Jackdaws love chimneys, and they like to build their nests in sooty chimney stacks. Unfortunately, they don't always check first to see if they are still in use. Rooks and jackdaws once inhabited the steppes. These days, though, they've abandoned the nomadic life and mostly live near humans. In order to search for food, they leave the city and roam the fields and meadows. Often, rooks and jackdaws swarm across the countryside together. In particular, the smaller jackdaws benefit from this partnership. The larger birds protect them from attacks by birds of prey, such as peregrine falcons, sparrowhawks, or goshawks. You do have to look twice to see the small grey birds among the large black rooks. Life in the flock doesn't just protect them from enemies. It also helps in the search for food. The birds observe each other constantly and so can profit from their comrades' successes. Here too, the small jackdaws benefit from the company of the large rooks. Their large beaks are particularly efficient at digging for insects and seeds. The clever jackdaws glean any leftovers, a much easier way of finding food than digging for themselves. Juvenile carrion crows can quite often be found in the group. Their beaks are not as pointed and strong, and they lack the grey facial colouring of the rooks. These mixed flocks of crows only occur in autumn and winter. In early spring, more and more of them leave the flock and fly off to their nesting grounds to get on with the business of breeding. But what is a jackdaw doing by the sea? The island of Norderney, off the north coast of Germany, is home to seagulls and waders like the Eurasian oyster catcher, and thousands of rabbits. Long ago, humans brought these long-eared creatures to the island as a source of food. They immediately felt at home in the wide sandy dunes, and the population exploded. The light sandy soil is particularly suitable for digging burrows, and there's more than enough food. Apparently, the jackdaws haven't forgotten the steps of their ancestors. They use abandoned rabbit burrows on the island as nesting holes. A rabbit's burrow is nearly as cozy as a chimney stack, just so long as it's nice and deep and dark. Jackdaws are also highly intelligent and have a very complex social and group structure. Konrad Lorenz, the famous behavioral scientist and Nobel Prize winner, studied them in detail. Within the colony, there is a clear hierarchy. A wide repertoire of gestures and sounds helps the birds resolve conflict within the group successfully, and they get on famously with their long-eared neighbors. Males and females remain together for life. It's often possible to recognize pairs by their synchronized movements. This pair is showing intruders where they consider the boundary of their territory to be. If threatening gestures don't settle matters, then sometimes a fight ensues. No one ever gets hurt, though, because jackdaws are bound not only by strong family ties, but also by a strong sense of community. The argument is quickly forgotten, and they get on with their daily business. Breeding has begun, and there are more important things to do than fight with neighbors. It is the end of April. In Limburg, The female rooks are also sitting on their nests. In the meantime, the males stand guard or fetch food from the fields and meadows outside the city, mostly worms and other small animals. This pair already seems to have chicks. Their beaks are stuffed with food. Rooks stow their food in pouches that hang like small bags under their beaks. To begin with, the males hand over the food to the females, who then feed the youngsters themselves. Later, both parents feed their young together. This chick has already got its first downy feathers. The bright red gullet is typical for members of the crow and raven family. It serves as a key stimulus for the parents to fill it with food. During the first days of life, the chicks are permanently guarded and kept warm by their parents. Later, the colony guards them. Just one cry and numerous birds rush to help. The young rooks spend a good 30 days in the nest, and afterwards they continue to be fed by their parents for a further 6 weeks, sometimes well into August. Crows make exceptional parents. After mealtime, it's time for a sleep. Feeding is tiring work at this age. Comburg Castle in the south of Germany, a huge abbey with 1,000 years of history. And a typical place to find jackdaws. In 1960, over 50 breeding pairs lived here. Then disaster struck. People began covering the towers and niches with wire, leaving the jackdaws with few remaining breeding places. And so, in 1990, nesting boxes were installed, with success. Today, over 30 pairs of jackdaws rear their young in Comburg Castle. Young jackdaws need secure nesting holes to protect them from predators like birds of prey, martens, and owls. But the success of the brood depends upon other factors. Bad weather and a lack of insects can have a negative effect, as can the inexperience of young parents. While rearing their chicks, the adult birds are constantly underway. As long as the chicks are small, they only really eat insects. So it's important that there's a meadow near the jackdaw colony. The greatest dangers arise when the youngsters leave the nest. Between 60 and 70% die within the first 5 months. Jackdaws don't find the same good living conditions everywhere. Due to the loss of breeding grounds and the intensive forestry and farming practiced in Central Europe, their numbers have dropped dramatically. In Baden-Württemberg, in Germany alone, numbers have gone from 3,000 pairs in 1960 to only 1,000 pairs today, a worrying trend that has since spread throughout the whole of Europe. Hans-Ulrich Stüber runs a jackdaw refuge in the area around Schwäbisch Hall. Thanks to his work, numerous nesting boxes have been built, and towers, churches and old buildings made accessible for the jackdaws again. In order to monitor the population, Stüber tags the birds every year. The situation this year is fairly good. The young jackdaws mainly feed on flying insects like cockchafers, summer chafers and grasshoppers. There are plenty of them around this year. We often have broods of four chicks, just like these, who are about 16 to 17 days old. Very round bellies, so they appear to be very well fed. On average, the adult birds have approximately four chicks, which all go on to leave the nest. There are a lot of old nesting sites in the region which become depopulated and which have now been recolonized. Today, Hans-Ulrich Stüber looks after about 180 pairs of birds and is internationally renowned as an expert on jackdaws. When he began his work in 1988, population numbers were at their lowest levels. Since then, they have increased steadily. From April to June, the police officer is always out and about, using his free time to check, document and ring the birds.
Mach's gut.
The Harz Nature Reserve in Germany. High above the ancient forests of the future, the king of the ravens, the common raven, circles the area. Mated pairs of common ravens like to remain in the same territory for life. With a wingspan of up to 1.30 meters and a body length of 65 centimeters, ravens are the largest songbirds in the world. It's mid-May. In the nest, high up on the cliff, two fledglings are waiting impatiently for their parents. Finally, one of the adults lands with a full beak. Now, just before their first flight, the two chicks are always hungry. They're about 6 weeks old, but they've not yet dared to take off into the unknown. Back in March, the female common raven laid two eggs and incubated them for 3 weeks. The two chicks have developed magnificently. This year, the supply of food was good. In a forest clearing, the entrails of a shot boar lie on the grass. Common ravens are omnivores, and fresh carrion is very attractive. Otherwise, at this time of year, they catch small animals, in particular mice, but also chicks, insects and earthworms. In a few days, the youngsters will leave the nest. Afterwards, the family will remain together until late summer. During this period, the young ravens learn a lot from their parents. Until the 1980s, the common raven was almost extinct in most parts of mid-Europe. Only thanks to strict protection measures has the population of this impressive bird been able to recover. A beech grove near Schleswig in northern Germany. Thomas Grünkorn is on his way to one of his raven nests. Since 1984, this biologist has studied and tagged young common ravens. In order to reach the ravens, he has to climb dizzying heights of 20 to 30 meters. The nests are located high up in the trees. Finding the right moment is imperative. If the chicks are more than 4 weeks old, they would try to escape from the nest, which could prove fatal. Grünkorn's research territory is 2,000 square kilometers in size. His data provides valuable biological information about the common raven, as well as information about its protection. In order not to disturb the birds too much, Grünkorn leaves as quickly as possible. The chicks are fairly stable, but the adult birds are not at all happy about the visitor. They will now stay in the nest for a good week. And then the phase begins when the birds slowly leave the nest and flit around in the top of the tree, perhaps a short flight to the neighboring tree and back again. We'll see that for the next 2 or 3 weeks. In about a month, the family will then fly as a group. 5 birds, 3 youngsters and 2 adults. We'll see them circling above the forest, and bit by bit, they will venture out into the surrounding area. On Norderney, the young island jackdaws are almost fully fledged. They spend most of their time sitting at the entrance of the nest. The bright blue eyes are typical. As they get older, the color slowly changes to light gray. The chicks are getting restless. They've heard their parents and are looking forward to a good meal. Carefully, the adult jackdaw approaches the nest on foot, his beak full of food. And then there's no stopping them. Insects form the main part of their diet. Then, as they get older, they eat grain and seeds too. In a few days, the chicks, which are already almost 5 weeks old, will take off and explore the island. Norderney is a paradise, not just for jackdaws. Excitement amongst the rooks in Limburg. The first chicks have left their nests and are flitting over the roofs and through the trees. An incessant squawking fills the city air. The chicks will keep their typical black faces until they molt in autumn. This gives them complete freedom of movement within the colony and ensures them the protection of the adult birds. Life slowly gets back to normal for the parent birds. Nonetheless, they'll look after their chicks for about another 6 weeks and prepare them for independence. Back to the region of Harz in Germany. An adult bird circles above the spruce forests and observes the surroundings closely. Then it turns and flies towards the forest clearing. The young ravens have left their nest on the cliff and are searching for food with their parents. A young bird carries off a chunk of meat to hide it. Typical behavior for ravens. Whatever can't be eaten straight away is stored somewhere. His brother was watching it, though, and rushes over. It gets a fright and backs off, trying to pretend there's nothing special going on. But the intruder smells a rat, and determinedly, he walks over to the hiding place and digs the chunk of meat out. The other chick does make an attempt to get its meat back, but the victor claims the prize for himself and finds his own hiding place. Suddenly, one of the parents shouts a warning call. A young female fox has appeared in the clearing. She's also probably caught the scent of the deer and wants a good meal too. Quickly, the young raven opens up his hiding place and fetches the chunk of meat. The fox is definitely not going to get his prize. Once again, the adult bird cries out a warning. Now things are getting risky. Instead, the young raven struts across the clearing as if it were no big deal. It seems to want to provoke the approaching fox. At the very last minute, the raven flies off. Better safe than sorry. Common ravens are too intelligent to take unnecessary risks. The increasing wilderness at the Harts Nature Reserve will benefit many animals and plants, not least the common ravens. Meanwhile, it's midsummer in Almsey. Activity at the Konrad Lorenz Research Station has reached its peak. After the geese and ravens have hatched their chicks, there are further tests to carry out. Once again, Anna Brown is on her way to Ilias and Colombo. She recently started a new series of experiments. It's clear from earlier experiments at various universities that ravens possess personal awareness similar to humans. Anna Brown wants to find out how strong their individual ability is to tell other ravens apart. And for this, she uses a computer with a touchscreen. To warm up, they do an experiment that the ravens already know, called fish and flower. It's important to note that the ravens participate in the experiments of their own free will. They can come and go as they please. On the screen, photographs of various fish and flowers appear. If Ilias taps fish, he gets a reward. That means correct. On the other hand, if he taps the flower, the screen turns red. Wrong. Okay, I got it. Now, Anna Brown begins the actual experiment. 8 of the wild ravens have each been photographed from 10 different perspectives. The aim of the experiment is to test whether 4 of the 8 birds shown on the screen can be recognized by the test bird, similarly to the fish and flowers game. If the bird gets it right, there's a reward. For the 40 pictures of the other 4 birds, there is none. This time, Colombo starts the test. That was right. Right again. Need a break? No, Colombo wants to try again. Right again. And again. Bother. This time, wrong. At the moment, Ilias and Colombo are in training. But it's already apparent that common ravens do indeed have highly developed powers of discrimination. In autumn, when the supply of food is poorer, crows form large winter flocks. Waste dumps are becoming more and more important as a source of food. Jackdaws are attracted here, as are crows and rooks, and in some areas, even the common ravens. Since burning household waste in Europe started, the waste dumps are no longer as attractive as they once were. But a few good morsels can still be found in the rubbish. Even a stork has discovered the dump. The abundance of food and the good local climate in such locations has resulted in some migratory birds staying at home near their breeding grounds rather than heading south in winter. Dumps are oversized man-made food sources, rather like the battlefields and gallows in the Middle Ages, if not quite as macabre. Either way, they attract flocks of crows that would not naturally occur under normal circumstances. As omnivores and scavengers, it's impossible for the crows to pass over a dump without stopping. A miraculous place in these times of scarcity. The flocks of juvenile birds benefit most from the dumps, but as a result, flocks grow to unnatural sizes. The birds also remain in one place far longer than they otherwise would, instead of roaming the countryside as they did in the past. For those who are unafraid of humans, towns and villages make ideal places to spend the winter. Particularly during the pre-Christmas period, it's easy to find food on the streets, as here on the Christmas market in Potsdam. The greyish-black hooded crow is the eastern counterpart to the carrion crow, and is easy to recognize by its contrasting black and grey plumage. In winter, these birds are even more attracted to the cities than their black-feathered cousins in the west. There's not just plenty to eat here. It's also warmer than out in the open fields, where a cold wind often blows in from the east. Almost paradise for crows. Rich pickings from a post office van. Scavenging leftovers from a park bench. Like all members of the crow family, hooded crows are torn between curiosity and fear of the unknown. Could the bag of rolls be dangerous? No. He who dares wins. It would be a shame to waste the chance of a delicacy. Just like all crows, hooded crows love walnuts more than anything. Walnuts are very nourishing because of their high fat, carbohydrate, and vitamin content. And it seems that crows love the taste of them. So the finder of a nut is never alone for long. The crows by the post office van have finished their meal. For any other bird, the empty dish would be uninteresting, but not for a crow. You can have great fun with one of these things, a clear sign of their above average intelligence. And they're still fighting over the nut. Laying in stores of food is also a sign of intelligence. A nut that can't be eaten now is set aside somewhere for a rainy day. And months later, the crow can remember exactly where it was left. He can only hope that no one saw where he put it. In 1884, Friedrich Nietzsche wrote, "The crows cry out and fly in swarms towards the city. Soon it will snow. Woe to him who has no home." But crows do have a home, because they know that winter is far easier to survive in the company of others. And so, in winter, they come into the cities every evening to spend the nights together. And while even at night the traffic continues to flow, flocks of crows congregate in the old resting places which have been passed on from one generation to another, as here in Frankfurt am Main.
And this ebony bird beguiling.
The clever crows have always followed us everywhere, and it looks as if that will never change.
Of the countenance it bore, though thy crest be shorn and be shaven, thou I said art sure, no, no craven, ghastly grim and ancient, the raven wandering from the nightly night show. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's plutonium shore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Quoth the raven, nevermore.